established pursuant to Section 519.13 of the Ohio Revised Code by the Anderson Township trustees to provide administrative relief to any person or entity adversely affected by the Anderson Township zoning resolution. Will the secretary please call the roll?
Steve Haver?
Here.
Brett Hayes?
Here.
Chris Howston?
Here.
Thank you for coming to this meeting of the Anderson Township Board of Zoning Appeals. Please be aware that this meeting is audio and videotaped and may be carried live on television, assuming that all this technological stuff goes according to plan. First, let me outline our procedures. We have four appeals tonight. A summary of each appeal is going to be presented by staff. Then the appellant will be able to present his or her case. The board members may then ask questions of the appellant. After that, all persons supporting the appeal will be permitted to testify one at a time after being recognized by the chair. When those persons supporting the appeal are finished, those opposed to the appeal will then be permitted to testify and/or ask questions of the board after being recognized by the chair. All persons wishing to testify whether for or against an appeal may only do so after being sworn in. When testifying, each person must come forward to either podium. After being recognized, speak into the microphone, state their name, address, and any affiliation to the case under consideration. All persons testifying will be limited to 4 minutes unless a board member requests additional time. All testimony is given to the board only. No comments or questions are to be directed to the appellant or anyone else in the audience. The board requests only new, non-repetitive evidence or questions. Should someone wish to show support of previous testimony, they may do so following the testimony procedures and stating their support of previous testimony. Now, will all persons who may give testimony this evening, whether or not you're going to give testimony or not, if you're in doubt, please stand.
Any applicant.
Any applicants. Raise your right hand and swear or affirm, do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Thank you.
We sort of had an image up there for a second.
We did?
No.
Oh, good. All right. Changes to tonight's agenda?
No changes to the cases. We won't be able to do the approval of minutes. We don't have quite the quorum that we did last month for those. And then you also will notice on your agenda, we do not have the continuation of the Maddox case. That will actually come back before us in November.
Okay. Cool. Thank you. Okay, then, item three on our agenda, consideration of case 24-2015-BZA, a variance to request to allow a six-foot-high privacy fence within the side yard. So we're going to ask staff to give their presentation.
So this is located at 650 Watch Point Drive, and as you said, the request this evening is to allow a six-foot-high privacy fence within the side yard area. The property is zoned AA residential. Here's a location map, the property in this location. The surrounding uses are all AA residents on north, south, east, and western sides, and the tract is approximately 1.1 acres. It has 150 feet of frontage on Watch Point Drive. It increases in grade toward the rear of the property, and the current use is a single-family home. We can see here an aerial photo of that site, and again, I'll highlight for you board members. That's the location of the home. So the applicant has installed a six-foot-high privacy fence within the side yard area. Typically, we only allow fencing in this location to be a maximum height of 4 feet. It's got to be 75% open. The home was constructed in 1993 along with a deck. In May of 2015, a violation was issued for the construction of that fence without a zoning certificate. The fence is 6 feet high and privacy style. It's within that side yard area. The applicant had previously had some large evergreens in that location that had to be removed, so they were seeking to just kind of get back that privacy in that location. And here we can see behind the basketball goal, there's the location of those evergreens that were removed.
Those were removed?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So staff finds that the variance is substantial. The applicant has installed a fence at 6 feet high and solid, where a fence that's 4 feet high and 75% open is permitted. The essential character of the neighborhood would be altered as a result of the variance. The only fencing adjacent to this area are those gateway features that are, you can see in this image here, that are greater than 75% open. Adjacent properties don't really have similar characteristics, though the home at 6381 Spyglass Ridge Drive does have a near solid fence that's visible from the roadway of Watch Point Drive. The quirk on this one is that it's because it's a corner lot, so that area is actually considered their rear yard, not a side or front. The property owner's predicament could be feasibly obviated by some method other than a variance. The fence could be replaced with a compliant type or additional landscaping installed for screening. And finally, the spirit intent of the zoning requirement would be observed and justice done by not granting the variance. The zoning requirement is for fencing 4 feet high or less and a minimum of 75% open.
Okay. Staff's presented their findings. Any questions from the board to staff? Nothing?
No.
Okay. Would the appellant or the appellant's representative like to come to one of the podiums, speak into the microphone, state your name, address, and any affiliation, and present your appeal?
I'm Kevin Rooney, the owner of the home. My wife is out of town visiting our daughter, so it's just me today. And good afternoon, board staff. You just want my explanation of, okay. Mm-hmm. Basically, I mean, I'm a Navy veteran, 25-year homeowner in Anderson. We had a windstorm last summer, real bad windstorm, and knocked down a bunch. There's real tall evergreens there along that, separating the 2 yards, whatever. And the trees fell down. I chopped them all up, whatever. And we had a choice, you know, either put landscaping down or put up a privacy fence, something like that. And the other trees were very tall, so... You know, I'm a pilot. I'm not a builder or anything like that. I mean, I just said, you know, how about put up a fence, whatever. Talk to the neighbors prior to that. They said, no problem. Told them what we're going to do. Went to the fence company and told them what I needed. And they said, fine. And they never, you know, I guess I should have known, but they never told me I needed a permit or any variance at all, that there is restrictions here in Anderson. So I just trusted the Eads company, and they put up the fence, and you know, it's a nice fence. We were happy with it, and then you know, I think a couple months later, I got a knock on the door saying that it's you know out of variance or whatever. So and so here we are. You know, I've talked to the neighbors; they're okay with it. You know, I have not had any complaints about it. If it does stay, you know, we could put shrubbery and bushes around it. I use Bezak. I've talked to Mark there, and he can do that. But and then that's basically my story here.
Okay. Do we have any questions for the appellant? These evergreens that are remaining, you said, were there other ones that were on down the line?
Yeah, there was probably about 7 of them, and I think 3 of them fell.
3 of them fell?
Yeah.
So you took those down and then...
Yeah, they fell in the opposing driveway, actually, and fortunately their car wasn't there, and I, you know, cleaned all that up.
Okay. Okay, any other questions? Nothing?
No.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
So we'll now take testimony for any of those persons here who want to speak on behalf of the appeal. Okay, is there anyone who wants to speak in opposition to the appeal? Any other questions or... that we have before we close this public hearing? Okay. Then we will close the public hearing portion on case number 24-2015 BZA. And let me just summarize again what our procedures are tonight.
Hey, magic.
Oh, we've got something beautiful.
Or not.
Is that we've got four cases tonight, and what we'll do is we will have a public hearing portion. What you just saw was a public hearing portion of a case where we will take testimony from people in the audience, either in favor or in opposition to the appeal. And then what that does is, once we close that public hearing, is that we will then take no more additional testimony. We will then do that for all our cases tonight, and then we will go back to this case and amongst ourselves deliberate and discuss merits of the case, and then take a straw vote. So I want to make sure that we are all aware of how we are going to proceed tonight. Okay, we did have it. We don't now. Okay, so then moving on to number four on our agenda, consideration of case 25-2015 BZA, a variance to request a front yard setback of 27.5 feet for an addition. If staff would make their presentation.
Sure.
Please.
Let's go to that slide. Okay. This property is at 6939 Clough Pike and is zoned B residence. The request this evening is to allow a 24-by-30 garage addition to have a front yard setback of 27.5 feet. And then the replacement and expansion of the front porch to have a setback of 17 feet 6 inches, where both of those required front yard setbacks is 35 feet. There's a location map of the property. It's here along Clough Pike, and there are technically two parcels here. One is 1.35 acres in parcel 29, and there's an additional 0.16 acres in parcel 221. In total, the property has about 450 feet of frontage on Clough Pike. And it does slope down towards that creek in the rear. Surrounding zoning on the south, east, and west sides is B residence. However, to the north is B CUP residence, where those apartments are. And here we see an aerial photo of that site, and you can make out where that creek line is. Those are some property photos. Here we've got a site plan. So the applicant is proposing to add a two-story, two-car garage addition to the east of the existing home and to replace the existing covered front porch with stairs, expanding it towards that garage addition slightly, but the depth of the front porch will remain the same as the existing. The home was constructed in 1914 and has an existing covered front porch. The home has no conforming front yard setback. It is a non-conforming setback. And it was built prior to Hamilton County zoning that was adopted in 1948. And because of that, it has never quite met up with our current day requirements there on Clough Pike. There, we can see a site plan. There's no other information on file for the property. And here we see images. You can see that front porch that is deteriorated and does need to be replaced. So the applicants would like to do that at the same time as the garage and then extend it east towards where that garage will be located. The image on the upper right here is the location of the proposed garage addition, as well as some other property views there. Staff finds that the variance is not substantial. The existing porch has had a setback of approximately 17 feet 6 inches from the right-of-way, and the applicant is proposing to replace that with another of the same depth, extending over to the proposed addition, which is a two-story garage with a setback of 27.5 feet, where 35 feet is required. The essential character of the neighborhood will not be substantially altered, and adjoining properties will not suffer detriment as a result of the variance. The area is a mix of uses, and the home has existed with a reduced setback for some time. The variance will not adversely affect the delivery of government services. And finally, the property owner's predicament cannot be feasibly obviated through some method other than a variance. While the property is very wide and has extensive frontage on Clough Pike, it's also very shallow. The applicant could not add the garage at the rear of the home and meet the rear yard setback requirements. So either way, it would end up before us at this board. And then any replacement of the front porch would require a variance, as the existing home's front yard setback is less than that 35 feet required.
Okay. Any questions of staff? So the front porch is going to come down. They're going to replace it to the same frontage that
yes,
is existing.
Yeah, and then a little bit wider to reach over to where that existing, where that proposed garage addition is.
Okay. And then it looks like that the new garage is actually set back a little bit.
Yes, it is. Let's see where we get to those.
Still not sufficient to be in compliance, though.
No.
Yeah. So the variance is really for both parts of the structure.
Yeah, and if you moved it back far enough to meet that front yard setback, you'd then be impeding on the rear yard setback.
Yeah.
Kind of a challenging site.
Yeah, it's a strange shape.
Yep. Okay, any other questions for staff? Okay, would the appellant like to come to the podium, speak into the microphone, state your name, address, and present your appeal, please?
Afternoon, folks. Thank you for the opportunity to address you. My name is Bill Buzik. My wife, Teresa, is in the audience, and I reside at 6939 Clough Pike with my wife. As you can see, the house has a farmhouse look to it. It's been there since 1914, and we're proposing to add a garage. The picture on the top right, that's where the garage will be. It's going to enhance the look of the house. We're going to keep it architecturally correct, and we're going to bump that porch in the direction of the garage about 4 feet. So what wasn't mentioned, the existing front porch, which has been there for some time, obviously, has a row of evergreen trees in front of it, so it's almost invisible from Clough Pike. The only logical place for this garage addition is within the confines of our plat plan. There's a window again on the picture to your top right. That garage will start right to the left of that small window and come back and actually cover up the other window. So we really can't go back any further without causing some difficulties to the property. I really have nothing else to add to that. Do you have any questions?
So that's why the setback for the garage from the front of the house is to preserve that one window.
Well, it just looks better too. So yeah, that addition on there, if you make a flush to the front, it just doesn't look correct. So any little offset, you can see by your great building here, the angles and the offsets make it pleasant to the
right
eye. So
okay.
And also we're going to change the direction of the steps. They face Clough Pike now, which is kind of useless. Now they'll actually face the side of the house, so it's a more friendly entrance. And if you notice this property, my wife got this property about 7 years ago. It was really in bad repair. And if just from the folks that have lived there and told us what she's done in terms of landscaping and the green space in back, done a really outstanding job.
Okay.
So we think that this will add to the look of the neighborhood.
Okay. Any other questions?
A quick question, sir. The planned finish is, you can't tell from the drawings that you submitted, the plan finish is intended to be essentially the same as the current farmhouse look?
Yes, sir. There's probably going to be a lower area, maybe two or three foot of brick or stone that'll wrap around to the porch. And then on top of that, there'll be some clapboard siding. So that new siding will match the stuff that's going to put on the house, too. So there'll be substantial remodeling of the whole property. But it'll mimic that farmhouse look. That's a good question.
Thank you.
So you're going to replace the siding or?
Yes, sir.
Cover it?
Eventually. Once you do the addition and the new siding's on, it
okay
probably match the house with it, yeah.
Okay. All right. Anything else? Questions? Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
You're welcome. Anybody else want to speak on behalf of the appeal? Is there anybody who is in opposition of the appeal? Anything else before we close the public hearing portion? Well, then on case 25-2015, we'll close the public hearing portion of the meeting. Okay, then number five on our agenda, consideration of case 26-2015 BZA, a variance request to allow a rear yard setback of 26 feet 7 for an addition. We would request staff to make their presentation.
Yes, this property is on Stoneleigh Lane and is zoned B residential. And the location map is here. It is not quite a corner lot, but kind of in that rounded curved area of the subdivision. And the variance request is to allow a rear yard setback of 26 feet, 7 inches for a 16 by 18 addition, where a setback of 35 feet is required. The property is approximately 0.242 acres and has 85 feet of frontage on Stonely. It's relatively flat in topography, and the existing use is a single-family home. As you can see here from our zoning map, the surrounding zoning on each side is B residence, and the surrounding uses are all single-family residential. And an aerial photo of that site. The applicant, as we see here in their site plan, is proposing to add, what did we just do? A 16 by 18 four-season room addition, as well as two uncovered decks, both to the right and left of that addition. The uncovered decks are to be sized 9.5 by 7 feet 4 inches and 16 by 16. The home is constructed in 1988, and there's no other information on file for the property. The staff finds that the variance is not substantial. There is an existing deck on the home, as we see here in this property photo, which is set back 26 feet 7 inches from the property line, which is that proposed setback of the addition. Decks are permitted to extend into the rear yard setback. Only the 16 by 18 area is proposed to be enclosed, while the other two areas are proposed to be open decks and have setbacks of 26 feet 7 inches and 20 feet 1 inch respectively. I believe there was a typo in your initial staff report, so those setbacks are corrected. The essential character of the neighborhood would be unaltered, and adjoining properties would not suffer detriment as a result of the variance. The applicant's property currently has a deck with section size 32 feet by 16 feet and 7 feet 4 inches by 9 feet 6 inches in that same location where the addition and new decks are proposed. The variance would not adversely affect the delivery of government services. And finally, the property owner's predicament cannot be feasibly obviated through some method other than a variance. The existing home has a rear yard setback of 42 feet 7 inches, so they would only be able to enclose a 7-foot area without a variance.
Questions of staff?
You, Allison, you had a picture of the surrounding properties. I think that the surrounding properties have fairly close additions as well.
Yeah, actually, the property directly south does have that little bump out on the rear of it that just grazes that setback requirement.
There's also a great deal of vegetation between those two houses. As I think I saw it in my tour of the property, that vegetation is not on the property owner's property. It is on the other property owner's property. Is that correct?
That would be a question for the applicant.
Okay. Thank you.
Anything else? So would the appellant please come to a podium and speak into the microphone, state your name, address, and present your appeal, please.
Good evening, and thank you for this opportunity. My name is Damian Billy. I'm an architect. I live at 1886 Madison Road, Cincinnati, Ohio, 45206. Mr. Gibson apologizes he could not be here today, but he's out of town on business. Ray and Carol have lived in the house about 27 years. They've raised their family here, and they're now getting a plethora of grandchildren, and they need more interior conditioned space to house all the grandchildren for Christmas and Easter and things like that. Rather than move, they would like to stay here. They like the neighborhood. They like their neighbors, and the solution is to build a Four Seasons room on the back of the house. If you look at the CAGIS map, you can see how the original developer swung the curve very wide for some reason. A typical curve wouldn't be that wide in the street. It pushed the Gibson's house farther back, which means their lot depth is less buildable area than any of the neighborhood houses there. If the curve had been put in, as most developers put in a curve, the house would be pulled up to be in line with the houses to the south, and a variance would not be required.
Okay. Do you know how much that difference is? Like, from the difference of the setback?
I've not measured it, but it's...
To that house, to the house to the south?
Yeah, it's a good deal. It's 10, 15 feet somewhere in there, and I apologize, I did not measure it.
Okay.
My question to staff on the vegetation, do you know what side of the property line the existing fairly dense vegetation is?
On the rear property line?
On the rear property line.
I think its majority is on the back neighbors, and there, but is a section of it on theirs also. So it's maybe two-thirds, one-third.
Is there any plan to alter any of that vegetation that is on the property owner's side of that line?
No, sir.
None? Thank you.
The size of this room, the enclosed room, is it roughly the size of, extend out as far as the existing deck? I'm trying to...
Yes, sir.
That's how big it is?
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
Any other questions? Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Anybody else want to speak on behalf and support of the appeal? Is there anyone that wants to make any testimony who opposed the appeal? Any other questions before we close the public hearing? Well, then, let's close public hearing on case number 26-2015-BZA. And finally, tonight is consideration of case 27-2015-BZA. This is a conditional use request from section 5.4 for an addition to Mercer Elementary, and I'll ask staff to give their report.
This should be very familiar to us now. I believe this is the last secure vestibule entrance addition that we will see in the elementary schools this year.
Other than Maddox.
Other than Maddox, which is going to come back before us.
Yeah.
So we've seen this a number of times. This location is 2600 Bartles Road and is zoned A residence, and the conditional use request is for a 297-square-foot secure vestibule entrance addition to Mercer Elementary. Here's the location map. I think we're all pretty familiar with this site. They are on the property with Turpin. The Mercer section is 28.27 acres and has 630 feet of frontage on Bartles Road. The parking field is generally flat, but as we know, it does have a steep downward slope south of the school building. Zoning to the northeast and west is all A residence with single-family residential uses, and to the south there is A CUP residence. And we can see an aerial photo of that site, as well as to the south there where that grade change is heavily wooded. And a site plan for us. The applicant is proposing a 297-square-foot addition to be a secure entrance for Mercer Elementary. There are also interior renovations to improve handicap accessibility, administrative offices, and classrooms, as well as some exterior modifications such as re-roofing portions of the building and cleaning the brick facade. Those changes, both the interior and exterior modifications, do not trigger the conditional use review through the board. However, that addition does trigger our conditional use standards. In 1994, a zoning certificate was issued for a new parking lot. In 1996, an 8x14 greenhouse was added, and in 2001, a variance was granted to allow a 32-square-foot freestanding sign on the property. No other information's on file for this particular structure. Here we see an elevation drawing of that proposed entrance, as well as property pictures. The bottom left, or sorry, bottom right, shows predominantly the location of that entrance. So for this, as you know, we don't use our typical variance standards that we've heard in the last several cases. We do turn to Article 5.4 of our resolution and the conditional use standards, which are the vehicular use area shall be located and designed so as to minimize impact on the neighborhood. In this instance, the parking area is not proposed to change. Measures should be taken to minimize the impact of potential nuisances such as noise, odor, vibration, and dust on adjacent properties. The addition of the secure entrance should not create an additional impact on adjacent properties. a boundary buffer of 10 feet with 3.3 canopy trees and 10 shrubs per 100 linear feet is required typically. In this instance, the proposed addition is located adjacent to the parking area, so the existing vegetation to the south of the school is not going to be impacted. Signage shall be regulated as follows. The sign standards in Article 5.5, Section F4. In this instance, signage is not being proposed. And finally, all exterior lighting shall be directed away from adjacent residential properties. Lighting is not being proposed.
Okay. Questions of staff? None? Okay. Would the appellant like to come forward and give us their testimony? Welcome back.
To be a regular occurrence. Ray Johnson, Director of Business Operations, Forest Hills School District. I live in the township at 8266 Eastdale Drive. As Allison said, this is the last of the renovations. We're adding security vestibule. We may be bringing, I'm not sure if the new Wilson will require us to come back. I guess it will. So, yeah, we're adding, we're butting out from the current entrance to create a security vestibule. There's, if you've been in Mercer, there's a stairway immediately going inside. We're going to be getting rid of that to try and improve the security of the building and also then have a tie-in to the office. So people will be buzzed in through the main series of new doors, come into the building, engage someone in the office before then released to go into further into the building. Our plan is to do the exterior work here during the course of the summer. So it's not going to be disruptive to the course of the school day. We will be doing work during the course of the school year, and we're trying to work out that plan right now. We actually met on Wednesday as a team to come up with things, what makes sense for us to do from a construction standpoint. We will then talk. We've been working hand in hand with Rick Martin with the fire department as well as the building department on what makes sense from their perspective, and then we meet with the building staff as far as educationally to make sure there's no disruption. But this one's very, very simple. This is really the only thing that will be noticed from the outside of the building, the change there outside of some roof replacement. Again, that won't be visible to the public.
Okay. Questions?
A quick question, sir.
Sure.
The other buildings that we have reviewed have had some minor additions to accommodate all day kindergarten services. This one, you already have enough space inside to...
Right. Well, what we're doing here, sir, is we have one of our early childhood programs is located at Mercer, and we're going to be relocating that to Sherwood. So we would have one on the far west end of the community. We have one at Summit on the far east end to balance them geographically. In the space that currently occupies, we will then move the district Head Start program. The area where Head Start is will be renovated, the interior for the additional kindergarten classrooms. So we don't need the three new classrooms as we're adding elsewhere, correct?
Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Anybody else want to testify in support of the conditional variance request? I should say conditional use request. Anybody want to speak in opposition? Close the public hearing? Then on this case, 27-2015 BZA, we will close the public hearing. All right, so then going back to the top of the order, case number 24-2015 BZA at Watchpoint Drive, a request to allow a 6-foot high privacy fence within the side yard.
Mr. Chairman, I'll start us off. This is a troublesome case for me, although we have seen similar cases with already constructed fences along the sidelines of properties that we have failed to grant a variance for because it is too great a change to the neighborhood. And I've I think that this is essentially the same situation. That fence is very visible coming through the neighborhood, into the neighborhood. I agree it's less visible on the way out of the neighborhood because of the terrain of the property owner's property. But it is visually obstructive on the way in. I think that the same separation from the adjacent property could probably be accommodated by some vegetation, even though it would not be as substantial and as high as the evergreen trees that were lost in the storm. So I would be inclined not to grant this variance.
Yeah, I think I'm in agreement there. You know, it's a well-kept house and lot, and you know, appears to be a very nice resident of Anderson making this application, but it does unfortunately protrude out, and it's a shame that the fence company wasn't clear, because some of them are very clear. Mm-hmm. when you ask, you know, a lot of them are cognizant of these issues, and they should be. But I'm with you. It just sticks out too far and is too visible.
Right. I agree with both of you. I think to reiterate those two points is we've had other fences come to us that have already been erected. And although that would seem a hardship, it's an unfortunate circumstance that we find ourselves in. Some fence companies are better at that than others, and so it's an unfortunate situation. As to what Mr. Hayes said, we've had similar fences. I don't remember where the last one was. It was over on Salem. Where we had a similar situation like this, where somebody had erected a privacy fence, 100% closed, 6 feet high, almost in the same location between the two residences that was constructed and built, that we denied the variance request. And I think for continuation for trying to figure out what that word is.
Consistency?
Precedence.
Yeah.
Precedence. That we continue to go along with that. So anything else?
I agree with you. I mean, I'll just add, just for the record, that, you know, if this fence had been in between two tightly nestled houses and not visible from the road, we may have a different, you know, outcome. But I agree with you that it's important to stick with precedent and consistency. And
because the one over on Salem had driveways, at least on one side, if not both,
right.
If I remember.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
I think a lot, you know, for cases like this, it's very important how visible it is from the road.
Right.
As opposed to the technicalities of the code, and unfortunately, this is very visible.
I would also add for the record that it is unfortunate miscommunications between the property owner and the fence company, is that it was specified on the checklist that the permit and the homeowners association approval were both to be done by the customer. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, I don't think that was ever signed and completed by the customer, but that's a shame about the miscommunications there.
Yeah, it wasn't signed. And, you know, the devil's in the details, and really in consumer transactions like this, there is a responsibility on the selling party, if you will, to inform the consumer. So I wouldn't be happy with my fencing company. I know that.
I agree.
If they moved forward without a signed agreement indicating responsibilities.
Well, yeah, and just generally explaining to the consumer.
Right.
You know, you're the professional. You hold yourself out as that, and you should explain to the consumer.
Yep.
These types of things.
These are always tough because they're just unfortunate.
Agreed.
Yep. Can we have a motion?
And Mr. Chairman, in the case number 24-20. 24-2015 BZA, property at 650 Watch Point Drive. I move that this board deny the request for a variance for a 6-foot high privacy fence that already exists, because it does change the essential character of the neighborhood with high visibility of a fairly large and full fence, and the needed separation and privacy between the properties could be accomplished by vegetation.
Okay.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to deny the variance request. Any other discussion? Betty, would you please call the roll?
Mr. Hayes?
Aye.
Mr. Houston?
Aye.
Mr. Hayter?
Aye. We are we deeply regret the circumstance that has come before you. We, for the reasons is that we don't feel that we can grant their request, and we hope that you might be able to go back to the company and see what you can do or whatnot regarding what has transpired.
No problem.
All right.
Allison, will I just give hold of you one night and take it down? Okay. All right, yeah. Thanks, you guys.
Thank you.
Sorry, sir.
Okay, going on to case number 25-2015 BZA. This is the garage addition, requesting a setback of 27.5 feet at, on Clough Pike.
Guess I'll start this one off. This is a very strange shaped lot. And I'm assuming, I don't have topography, I don't believe, I'm assuming it's, you know, maybe possibly due to some elevation in the backyard. Regardless, the lot is what the lot is. And it, you know, it's, the building's been there a long time.
That's a creek in the back.
Is it a creek? Yeah, so they're limited, you know, what they can do.
Right.
The house has been there, non-conforming use, you know, since the early 1900s. I think the additions are tasteful, and I think it will look good. So for that reason, I don't think it's substantial. And in addition, I don't think it's substantial because it's not, no portion of the structure is going to be any closer to the right-of-way than the structure already is.
Right.
So I'd be inclined to grant this variance.
Okay.
I agree, and I would add that the there is a substantial vegetation break between the residence and Clough Pike, which also aids in granting this variance, in that it will make no fundamental changes from the point of view of the road of Clough Pike.
Okay. Yeah, if there was ever a definition of hardship, I think this is pretty. This is pretty plain, but you can't put a garage, you can't put an addition on here and not either encroach into the front yard or the backyard or both. So I am inclined to agree with you and staff's finding that that we go ahead and grant the variance. So can we have a motion to approve?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, in case number, BZA case number 25-2015, regarding 6939 Clough Pike and a variance request to allow a 24-by-30-foot garage addition to have a front yard setback of 27.5 feet and a front porch to have a setback of 17 feet 6 inches where a 35-foot setback is required. I move to grant the variance on the grounds the same is not substantial. The essential character of the neighborhood would not be altered. The variance would not adversely affect the delivery of governmental services, and the property's owner's predicament cannot be feasibly obviated through some other method other than a variance, and also that the spirit and intent behind the zoning requirement would be observed and substantial justice done by granting this variance. Can't remember the usual parameters on restrictions as far as commencement and completion we put. I believe it's started within 6 months, completed within a year.
One and two.
One and two. Started within 1 year, completed within two.
Second.
What about compliance of the drawings dated, I've got September 9th.
I think that's a good idea.
Good.
So that in substantial compliance with the drawings dated September 9th. And then one thing I would ask is that when you talked about the owner's predicament cannot be feasibly obviated through some other method, is that the property is extremely shallow and cannot accommodate the addition without encroachment into either front or rear yards.
Correct.
Okay.
Either would require a variance.
Either, exactly. That would be our definition of hardship here. Okay. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second. So we have a motion to approve and a second. Any other discussion?
I would like to add, if you're okay, Mr. Houseman, that the finish would be, the finish and trim would be in substantial conformance with the existing house, or the existing house as modified.
Okay. Absolutely. I think that's a great idea.
Good idea. Anything else? Motion and a second. Betty, would you call the roll, please?
Mr. Hayes?
Aye.
Mr. Houston?
Aye.
Mr. Hayward?
Aye. So a matter of procedure again is, once we get through the cases, we are going to come back and officially approve and journalize them. And then we will create the paperwork for you later this evening. You're more than willing to stay or contact Allison in the morning in order to get the paperwork that approves the variance. Okay? Thank you. Appreciate
Thank
it.
You.
Okay, going on to case number 26-2015. This is a variance to request a rear yard setback of 26 feet 7 for a 16 by 18 addition, where a setback of 35 feet is required.
Now, Mr. Chairman, I am in favor of this board granting this variance for the reason that I do agree with the staff that the variance is not substantial. There is significant vegetative separation between the property owner and the most approximate other property owner, and that other property owner has the option of retaining that most of that vegetation as a visual break. The enclosure of the of a room is about as small as you can get a fit, even with the variance there, that would be of a substantive addition to the existing property. So I think this is a good investment in the property, worthwhile, and it is not a significant change to the surrounding neighborhood.
Okay.
Yeah, I largely agree. I do I do feel like we're cramming a lot in a little space here, but I'm a big fan of Three Seasons Room, and I agree that the vegetation plays a large role. But I just wanted to throw that a little bit of equivocation in there for future cases. It's not always going to be a rubber stamp, but I think in this case I agree with the remainder of the board on that.
I was kind of on the fence about this, and I know that based on lot configuration we've approved, I think a couple months ago we had a case where we did a three-season room, and the rear property line was at a severe angle to the back of the house. And but what really struck me about this was the testimony by the architect relating the house directly to the south. that if you put a three-season room on the back of that at the same size, you'd be okay. You know, it would be approved, so we've got some lot issues. And I'm all in favor of maintaining open space to the best that we can, but I, but given that, I'm willing to go along with this variance here just because of that fact. I think, again, we've got a hardship issue based on the testimony of the architect where the setback of the front yard pushed that house back and prevented it from complying and putting some addition on the backyard. On the back of the house that would encroach into the backyard. So I agree with what you said and add that too. So how about a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that this board in case number 26-2015 BZA, property at 7866 Stoneley Lane, grant the requested variance to allow a rear yard setback of 26 foot 7 inches for a 16 by 18 foot addition, where a setback otherwise would be 35 foot required per the Anderson Township zoning resolution. The variance, while numbers look very significant, the 26 7 foot setback versus 35, the rest of the rest of the variance is not that substantial. It does not materially change the feel of the neighborhood, especially with the vegetation break to the property owner to the south. The essential character of the neighborhood with them would not be altered. The variance would not adversely affect the delivery of governmental services. And the property owner's predicament cannot be feasibly obviated through some other method, and chiefly due to the large setback on the front of the house as set by the original builder many years ago. The spirit and intent behind the zoning requirement would be observed and substantial justice done by granting the variance. I would add conditions that the construction begin within 1 year and be completed within 2 years and be in substantial compliance with the drawings submitted and dated September 10th, 2015.
I'll second that. I think you nailed that.
You did nail it. We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? Betty, call the roll, please.
Mr. Hayes?
Aye.
Aye.
Mr. Haber.
Aye. Again, we're going to go through the process tonight of approving and journalizing and coming up with the paperwork. Again, you're more than welcome to stay or see Allison in the morning and she'll have everything ready for you. Okay? You're welcome. Thank you. Okay, finally then going on to the conditional use request. Mercer Elementary School, case number 27-2015.
I'm hanging in there. Yeah, thank you. I guess I'll start this one. Thank you. Yeah, this is a pretty easy one for me. Improvements to our schools, I'm always a big fan of. And I also, you know, looking at the overhead bird's eye view of this, it doesn't protrude out any further than it already is. It's going to add a lot of value to our community. I think as long as, you know, the school board or governing body, you know, follows the requirements of the code in the construction, I have no problem.
I completely agree. This fits all of the conditional use requirements that this board should consider in evaluating this request, the renewal of the conditional use. And the modifications are so minor that this is not affecting any of those conditional use requirements. So I'm in favor of granting this variance, granting the conditional use.
Yes. I echo what you just said, Mr. Hayes, regarding the requirements for meeting the conditional use, that they're met. Motion to approve the conditional use request. Whose turn?
I believe it's mine. Mr. Chairman, in case number 27-2015 BZA regarding 2600 Bartles Road, for a conditional use request pursuant to section 5.4 of the Anderson Township Zoning Resolution, I move to grant the conditional use on the grounds that the same will not affect the vehicular use area. I'm sorry, let's just make this simple. On the grounds that it's compliant with section 5.4 of the Anderson Code, and that the construction should take measures to minimize the impact of potential nuisances such as noise, odor, vibration, and dust on adjacent properties, and further comply with section 5.40 and I regarding the buffer with canopy trees and shrubs, and that the construction should begin within a year and completed within two. Have I hit everything that's relevant to this?
In substantial compliance with the
right
drawings.
Absolutely.
Dated,
I guess, September 8th.
September 8th.
That's the one that has, at least this one, this picture.
Yep. Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? Betty, call the roll, please.
Mr. Hayes?
Aye.
Mr. Houston?
Aye.
Mr. Hayes?
Aye. Okay. We have completed our deliberations, and what we're going to do now is to create the actual documentation for signature. So we are going to take a few minute recess and allow staff to do that. So you're more than willing to stay, or again, contact Allison tomorrow for anything that you might need. Thank you so much. Appreciate your being here. Oh, there you go.
And you have enough information to write that up, though?
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So this is the case 2.
I
Fred and Sheila Bass?
We don't actually have to move.
We don't?
No.
Okay. All right.
For somebody to do chair, desk, vice chair, and secretary, we just have whoever is going to have a motion for it.
Oh, good.
In the first line there, Allison, the matter was heard in October.
Yeah, that's not a month.
It's Uber. I read that and just ran right away. It's been a long day. Long period. Okay, I'm good.
There's a water down there too, hello.
Choked out.
Modification of the existing home.
You could,
yeah, because he said he may modify it.
Yeah.
What was number one there, though? That's it. Yeah, substantial performance requirements dated September 9th. And that is the right date. Is that correct? September 9th, yes.
Yep. Motion to approve and journalize.
Mr. Chairman, I move that this board, in case number 25-2015 BZA, approve and journalize the granting of this variance as drafted.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Betty, call the roll, please.
Mr. Hayes?
Aye.
Mr. Houston?
Aye.
Mr. Haber?
Aye. Sweet. Now we're going to go on to Stoneley. So this is 26-2015 BZA.
Yep. How can I miss that?
I just read it again. I wasn't going to miss it again. It was there.
Down about the fifth line down, you've got a capital A variance and needs. It should just be small. That's it.
I
September 10th, right?
The home has a, it's not a deeper front yard. It is a front yard that has been set back from the surrounding properties.
Our home has been set back, right?
Yeah, not the front yard.
The front, the home has a, which do you want? Do you want the home has been set?
Yeah, the home has been.
The home has been set back relative to surrounding properties.
You can do, due to the configuration of the right of way.
That's good, yeah.
And then you say pushing the home, you can probably get rid of that. Yep. There we go, you probably added in there.
Good.
Okay, so substantial conformance, 1 year completed within two. Anything else? I'm on a motion to approve and generalize.
Move to approve and generalize as written the decision in case 26-2015 BZA.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? Betty, call the roll, please.
Mr. Hayes?
Aye.
Mr. Houston?
Aye.
Mr. Hayes?
Aye. And then finally, we have the conditional use request. I'm going to look that up.
Oh, it's spelled correctly. That's the owner's, but that's not the, oh, okay, 2600 Bartels Road, yes, okay, got it.
To allow parking modifications, yep. To allow building modifications, or building, to allow a building addition.
Yeah, go back up a little bit further. That's good, right there. You've cut and pasted all of those conditional use pieces? How do we introduce those conditions? Can you go up just a little bit?
We didn't. We need that.
Yes. Just right in front of the top of the second page there, then.
Yeah, something.
Start out your second page with. Yeah, the conditional use is hereby granted, but that's close enough. Yep, you can copy that.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, in the case number 27-2015 BZA, Mercer Elementary School, I move that this board approve and journalize as drafted the conditional use.
Second. Motion and a second. Any other discussion? Betty, if you call the roll, please.
Mr. Hayes?
Aye.
Mr. Houston?
Aye.
Mr. Haber?
Aye. Anything else to come before the board?
The we will definitely meet on the
November
5th. Okay.
And we expect to have Matt back to us by that time.
The the action that I should take, or do you expect to, do we know anything about the membership of the board at that time?
I'll ask Jeannie what her plans are. I believe she can attend. If not, we'll have you watch the tape.
How about you two gentlemen? Are you going to be here?
Yeah. I should be.
Okay.
Yeah.
So if Jeannie can be here, then I won't watch the tape. If she can't be. Okay.
Do we know what happened to Amy tonight?
I don't know. She was not scheduled to be an alternate this evening, and then Brian Johnson let me know maybe like 2 hours ago.
Oh, gotcha.
Make it, so I called her and left her a message and said, come if you can. But
gotcha.
Okay. How do I get the tape?
I will send you a link from Anderson Community Television. It's just a YouTube.
Super. Super.
We changed the agenda.
If anybody
night.
Gets bored, you can watch those anytime you want.
I am thankful that I am not a subscriber to the to Time Warner Cable, so I can't get it normally.
I'm just glad I'm not bored.
We do need a motion to adjourn.
We need to move to adjourn.